purpose of this channel is the good news, sharing the good news, the real good news, and helping us get used to that. Our major problem is we're afraid, we're not used to good news because why? We've been telling ourselves, reinforcing over and over and over and over and over, a make-believe bad news, that there's a flaw in reality, that we're flawed, reality's flawed. We've been reinforcing this terrible, terrible, fake bad news for so much that we don't have any idea really about what good news is. We live in a hell of bad news, actually. We live in a hell of bad news, and we're just so used to it. I mean, what worse news could we possibly have than to believe that we're a body? I mean, that's the worst news you could ever get. Say, guess what, spirit? I got some really bad news for you. You're a body of this of blood and sinews and muscle and nerve tissue and flesh and breathing and having to eat and excretion and vulnerability and death, and you're a body. Oh, that's inconceivably terrible news. And then guess what? All spirit is body. All spirits are bodies. And these bodies live in this world full of microbes and fungus and viruses and all sorts of illnesses. You want to travel to somewhere, you have to get, 10 different vaccinations, and you're going to get real sick and your body starts getting all arthritic and painful. And yeah, that's pretty bad news. It's terrible news, isn't it? Now, the good news is that the bad news is totally made up. It's completely fanciful. Okay, but we're not accustomed to really good news. We're not accustomed to it. This is our entire problem, actually. And nowhere that I can find in the world is there anyone who's focusing on this and saying, bringing the good news and saying, this is what we have to do, is get used to good news. But this is what we have to do. There isn't any way around it. It's so ingrained in us. This masquerade is so ingrained in us, believing that all this bad news is true, that it has become a continuity issue, a continuity problem, to even listen to any good news. We spend our whole life just kind of hunkered down in a defensive a trench, as it were, just trying to avoid all the terrible bad news that is flying everywhere, and trying to just pass on the bad news to the next generation, soldier on as best we can. And we pay zero attention to truly good news. Zero attention. Jesus came to bring the gospel of gospel of salvation. From what? From bad news. From false bad news. Now, it isn't easy to keep generating good news. Our habits are so terrible that we keep falling back into them. And I'd like to relay great good news to everybody every single day. And so I'm asking the Holy Spirit to give me some, better news so I can pass it on. And so we can just keep getting used to it. And once we get used to it, what's to stop us from just setting down this fake bad news all together, the whole thing, to say, hey, I don't need any of that bad news. It's all completely fake. It's all made up. Every last bit of bad news there could possibly be is completely made up. Okay, here's some really good news for everyone in the world. Every last bit of bad news that could ever be, whatever bad news we could ever imagine, it's all made up. Reality has no bad news for anyone. There is not one iota of bad news for any in all of reality. There has never been, is, and it will never be even one iota of bad news, ever, okay? Impossible. All bad news is completely a fantasy. Just a fantasy of our imagination, our spiritual imagination. So, this is very good news. Very, very good news. There is bad news is completely unreal. So our minds are kind of reeling at this and saying, wow, I don't know what to say about that. Well, there's nothing we can really say about it. It's better than anything we can say, right? Because commentary is we're so used to commentary. Well, commentary is all about levels and degrees of bad news. And we call this different differentiation, well, relative good news, relative bad news. But here, there's no relativeness about it whatsoever. It's completely all-encompassing, pure abstract, no exception whatsoever. And so there's nothing really to comment on. So conceptually, we're speechless about it. What can you say about there's never even a speck of bad news ever for us? What can you say about that? Any commentary is damning the situation with faint praise, isn't it? Any commentary. Damning the situation with utterly faint praise. Bad news doesn't exist. It's impossible for it to exist. We're not bodies. We're not bound by time, space, process, or form at all. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. This is the good news. I'm not a body, I'm free, I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. So it's helpful for us to keep reminding ourselves of the good news as much as possible. It's a discipline. It doesn't come easy or seemingly naturally because our continuity fear, we're so unused to it. And again, most people I've seen never ever entertain any good news in their life. It's all relative bad news. Well, I lived another year. You know, I lived this long. But now I die. Well, I got all these illnesses, but I was healthy for a while, you know, and I got some money, but I fear that I don't have enough, or my health is okay now, but you know, I have good relationships, but I'm feeling a little, you know, they may not last, or yeah, this is a good situation, but I'm not really sure how long it's going to last. This is all relative bad news, actually. Good and bad, good and bad, good and bad. But the truth is about us, about spirit, is there's no bad news. I am perfect. I am free. I'm still spirit exactly as God created me. There are no situations. There are no circumstances. There are no fixations. I'm absolutely sovereign over all my experiencing. All is one eternal life. And all is perfect. There's no flaw in reality whatsoever. Again, but we've ingrained this belief and we're familiar with this play of good news, bad news, which is really just relative degrees of bad news. Because again, with believing that we're the body, that's like the worst news possible. And then we say, well, we're the body, but we're not suffering the worst that the body can suffer at this point. And we say, oh, that's good news. I'm relieved that I'm not going to be, you know, savagely tortured at this point. My execution has been stayed for a little while. Oh, what great news, you know. That's not great. Good. That's not good news. That's just torture, really. So the good news of reality is not relative to any bad news whatsoever. The good news is that there is no bad news. If you want to speak of good news, the good news is that there is no bad news for anyone. It's impossible. We are simply misperceiving in an effort to claim that there is a flaw with reality. So, I would love to experience, the great good news. And since we have such a sphere continuity problem, it does the good news does tend to have feel a bit relative, has some relativity to it, because we're trying to get closer and closer and closer to just the absolute good news. It's not relative to any bad news whatsoever. It's not fixing any bad news. It's not curing any bad news. It is simply the intrinsic nature of reality. We're getting closer and closer to that. So, I have been having experiences while my body is asleep of interacting with what one would think of as enlightened beings, which is good news. And so, each one of us should try to ask for, I want to experience, good news. I want to have good news. I want to have experiences I can pass on and say, hey, this is what I have experienced. You can say, I'm experiencing enlightenment. I'm experiencing the vision of oneness. I'm experiencing the abidance in the non-dual. This is something that we should pass on to the whole world, and let them know that this is possible. Because otherwise, how can we break down? How can we evaporate the continuity fear that everyone has? Isn't that not possible unless there's good news enters into the world? This is Jesus is called the good news, the gospel, the light of the world, the good news entering into this world. Say, hey, guess what, everyone? You're not a body. You're free. You're still spirit exactly as God created you to be, and you have eternal life. There's nothing that can touch you. There's no bad news that can touch you. You're eternal. You can never die. Jesus brought all this good news to us. And we should be constantly chewing on that, like a cow chews on its cud. Keep chewing on the good news, so we get used to it. Bad news is easy. You open up the newspaper and say, okay, well, where's the bad news? I want to see something I'm used to. I do this, you see the newspaper and you say, uh-oh, I think it's full of bad news. Yeah, and then you say, well, I kind of need to feel like normal today, so, let me see some of this bad news. And I say, okay, now I feel normal. I feel full of fear. I feel bad. I feel lousy. I feel, what a terrible world. And I say, okay, well, at least everything's normal. At least everything's familiar. And if you don't pay any attention to the news, you start feeling a little weird. Like, say, wait a minute, where's all the bad news? What's wrong? We're so desperate for good news. We go looking for it everywhere we can. I just think, wow, maybe a game, a contest, and we see somebody wins, our team wins, and we say, oh, that's great news, good news. And then next day they lose, and we say, ah, terrible. Can't we have good news that lasts? We say in this world, nothing good lasts forever. Well, can't we have some good news that we can say, this is perpetually this way. It's perpetually good news. I'd like that. Because how good can the news really be when it's only temporary to be replaced by bad news? So can we find a good news that's permanent? It's permanent. Absolutely, this is what we are looking for. This is what we are told by those who have found it, that it certainly does exist, and we can find it too. We just have to stop running after it. I was thinking of this book called The God Chasers or something like that. And the idea is we need to be running after God, chasing God, trying to catch God. Well, how can we catch God? God's everywhere. And so we're running after God. Well, is God running away from us? Is God somewhere we have to run after God? As long as we're chasing after God, we can't never find God. The good news is that God is everywhere. It's impossible to not to be separate from God. We can't. God's not some object that we're chasing after. God is like pure subjectivity, pure beingness. It's sort of just like an objectless state. Now, it's hard for us to believe that this is possible, but this is the. There's three aspects to God. There's the Satchitananda, consciousness, being, consciousness, and bliss. I guess Sat would be being, Chit, Sat, Chit, Chit, awareness, I guess, and Ananda is bliss. God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. But Franklin Merrill Wolfe, who was an American mystic here in, spent a lot of time in California, Lone Pine, California, wrote a couple of books, Pathways to Space and Consciousness Without an Object, were a couple of his books, I believe. And the Consciousness Without an Object is very interesting. And he says that if you the realization is that of consciousness without an object. Consciousness without an object. Now we say, well, how is that possible? So right away, my mind is saying, "Wow, well, wait. You can't just have consciousness without an object. How can that be?" Well, pure subjectivity. It would be consciousness without an object. Pure subjectivity. Pure beingness. So, is that possible? Is beingness its own object? And we can look at this. Is it possible to look at this? I hope so. I mean, I read that so long ago. It must have been 35 years ago or so. Or more. I don't know. It's been a long time. And I still, well, we're here, or at least we're looking at this. Our mind has a hard time with that. He also spoke of it as high indifference, as like consciousness without an object would just be indifferent to any appearance or non-appearance. What you could say is just the ground of pure potential, not choosing anything appearance in particular. But remember, God is three aspects. The second aspect is, you would say, being consciousness, which would be consciousness of something, I would say. So Franklin Merrill's Wolf equation is maybe a little bit off, a little bit misleading. Let's look at this. Because then bliss is the consciousness experience of the dance of appearance. And the three aspects as one, we would say, constitutes God. So God is not just the beingness, the pure potentiality, zero dimensionality of consciousness without an object, so to speak. It's the three aspects all as one. So we're just looking at this here. See if we can we know we can get a breakthrough in some way, so we're just patiently sitting quietly. This is how you do it. If you want to succeed, sit quietly and be patient. Just don't be in too much of a hurry. Don't think that there's some task that we're timed. Part of the very bad acculturation we have in this world is these time tests in school. You have to, you have a certain amount of time. You have to do it fast. That is an incredibly bad habit to have. So in spiritual teaching, we're not timed here. There's no time. No clock on us. The educational system is an absolute abomination here, spiritual abomination. And those who have thrived in that are what you call the losers. And those are the ones that are in control of the world right now. Spiritual losers who thrive in abominable habits, really. And they think that they have some sort of authority to tell the rest of us what to do. They shouldn't have any such authority. And we shouldn't give it to them. Nobody should give that to them. We should insist that we're free. I'm not a body, I'm free. There's no timing on truth. Truth isn't something that's time. So our continuity fear makes it that we cannot put ourselves under the gun as far as I have to get this in 5 minutes, and come up with an answer. No, we're patient. We understand that we're nervous about all this. Some say that God is both consciousness of no object and consciousness of object. Yes, and the bliss of that. The Tibetan Buddhism has also the three bodies of God, the Dharmakaya, Sambhogakaya, and Nirmanakaya, something like that. Also talking about the three aspects of God. Three as one. All is one in the now, right now. It's not three separate aspects integrating one another. It's a threefold trikaya, threefoldness. Now we may be forgetting one of those aspects, and thinking that somehow we're separate from that, and we would say the aspect of God we're forgetting is consciousness without an object, okay? Which we might say is pure spaciousness. Pure spaciousness gives a matrix of sameness to all appearance. So the aspect we're forgetting is this pure spaciousness, and yet we tend to think that, well, that is God, but it's an aspect of God. It's one of the three basic aspects, the beingness, just the pure beingness without being any particular appearance at all. This allows all appearances to arise and to be free and to be non-fixated. So it's when we are aware of the non-fixatedness of all appearancing that the third aspect of consciousness is experienced, which would be bliss, or third aspect of God, which would be bliss. So we're missing two aspects. We're missing, when we miss the ground of being aspect of God, we also miss the bliss aspect of God. So we merely have consciousness we have consciousness of objects or appearances, but it feels fixated to us. So when we realize the pure spaciousness aspect of God, then simultaneously we will experience the bliss aspect of God as well. And so all three aspects, ground of being, consciousness, and bliss, will be experienced as one, and we call that self-realization, God-realization. So we're just missing this very little shift we can make to allow awareness of pure spaciousness, the ground of being aspect of God, to be the presence. And this gives us the feeling of the presence of oneness, which gives us this bliss. It comes along with that. So, if we're aware of why is it that we're feeling bliss now? Because we're experiencing God as God is, which is the three aspects of God. And now, consciousness of appearance is no longer feels fixated. We feel the absolute sameness, that we can never speak of fixation, because all is always perfectly abiding in pure spaciousness. So when the key though is that the bliss comes when we recognize this pure spaciousness, and then we feel whole, like we're feeling the totality once again. We've been trying to insist that reality has a flaw, and so we have simply been trying to turn pure spaciousness as if it were an object, or if it were a consciousness relating to objects, instead of a pure consciousness without any object. And so thus we're non-blissful. So this is very good news. To identify what could be, a very key element of our perplexity. You know, where does the bliss come from? How is the realization? Why is this so profound? Because that we see everything in its natural disposition once again. appearances never stray from perfect non-fixation. They never stray. As I've said, for instance, a bottle, you have it like this, and it's in pure, abiding 100% in pure spaciousness, and then you turn it like this, it's still abiding in 100% pure spaciousness, and it has not strayed from that. Okay, so there's no straying taking place anywhere. Nothing is straying whatsoever from the ground of being. Nothing astray. There is no straying. Nothing has gone astray. Therefore, nothing has to be brought back from its straying, actually. It's impossible to stray in relation to pure beingness. It's impossible to stray in relation to pure spaciousness, and thus there is no relation to pure spaciousness. There's only isness. There's not a relationship. It's isness. Because when we talk of a relationship, you can talk of it implies, well, it's in relationship, as if it could be out of relationship, but there's no such possibility. So we use a term, we have to use some non-dual term, because we just decide to, we'll call it isness. And of course, if you want to be contradictory, you would say, well, you can always say non-isness too. But for the sake of speaking to this, we agree upon a term that points to singularity, non-dual. We call it just isness. Ultimately, of course, nothing we can say about it, because we can always be contrarian if we want to, and words are just symbols. But so we'll use just the term, you know, isness. Nothing strays from being 100% included in pure spaciousness. 100%, with never does it become 99%. So this bottle is like, let's say it's 100% abiding in pure spaciousness like this. And if we go, you know, shake it like this, does it become 99%? You know, if we move it like this and shake it and go in a circle, and you look at all the water, you know, just, does it ever become 99.9% abiding in pure spaciousness? Now, I can say this, that we believe, perceptually, we believe that we are capable of experience, we're expectant of coming across a 99.9% inclusiveness. And so we're kind of like, we keep hoping or believing, not hope, expectant that this is going to happen. We call this life. You know, we call this human life. We call this life what we're doing. All we're doing is we're expecting the impossible to happen, and we think we want to be part of that, because this is going to be some sort of unprecedented experience for us. We're searching for that experience of 99.99%. inclusiveness in pure spaciousness, but not 100%, you see. So, but that never happens. It never happens. So we just remain in this expectant condition. We're never giving birth to it. We keep trying to give birth to it. We just can't give birth to it. I never have, never will. But there's a subtle hope that, you know, we're searching for this, you know, amazing experience where something will be not totally inclusive in pure spaciousness, that somehow if it just moves a certain way, if some alignment happens somewhere, that somehow, we think we're all beholden to the alignment of the stars, alignment of this, alignment of that, positioning. What does positioning of anything, any appearance, have to do with its inclusiveness and pure spaciousness? It has, what, how much? 0.001% something? No, zero. Zero. It has nothing to do with it. That means that no matter what alignment you have in the entire universe, trillions and trillions of stars, and, 10 times that of planets, and imagine all these planets teeming with form and activity and all this, and this going on for trillions and trillions and trillions of years, there is not any, not even the one iota of anything in all of that that will ever be not included, perfectly included in pure spaciousness. Flawlessly included. No 99.99%, but 100% always. There's no activity that somehow makes this play of appearance somehow separate in some way from pure spaciousness. This is why the ground of being, which we refer to as God, but really God, that's an aspect of God. There's Sat Chit Ananda, being, consciousness, and bliss is the fullness of God, and we have to see God in its fullness. So we're just looking together at this. It's a fruitful looking. We're smoothing out some rough edges here is what we're doing. We're used to thinking of that as that aspect as that's God. That is God. But it's more like it's that aspect of God which we have been denying and insisting that it's somehow not all-inclusive. And we think that we have developed all this massive new reality of all these layers and levels of experiencing and such. But Jesus says that all we've done is simply experience fear. That's it. We either experience fear or love. There's no other feeling. And all we're doing actually has been experiencing a detour into fear. That's it. But we believe that we've created all these layers and levels and all this, but it's just relativity. It's just all fear, actually, is what it is. All these alignments. Thinking, well, this is producing a potentiality. This is another potentiality. There's all these different potentialities for what? For non-inclusion, non-perfect inclusion. And so we've created this massive play that we think is full of potentiality. So we think we've created a new creation of pure potentiality. The pure potentiality of what? Of a flaw in reality, actually. But it's only fear. It's only fear. You've just been experiencing fear. So we think there's all these alignments. We don't realize that right now everything is in relation to God. Primarily, you cannot separate that out from the Godness. You cannot separate an appearance out of pure non-appearance, or even zero dimensionality. Even a non-appearance is abiding in pure spaciousness. The unmanifest and manifest, both equally abiding in pure spaciousness. You cannot separate that out. That's an inherent aspect of creation. Everything, all appearance, is inherently existing in God perfectly. There's no alignment question whatsoever. There's no quality question whatsoever. There's no motion question whatsoever. There's no purpose question whatsoever. There's nothing that needs to be said whatsoever about this fact. And we are not seeing the fact, the unqualified fact. We're trying to qualify it. So the unqualified fact of pure abidance and pure spaciousness is what we're overlooking. And what all we're seeing is qualifiedness. And we see everything has this has this qualifiedness, rather unqualifiedness. Meaning that we have a question about its beingness. We say, well, look at this quality in relation to other qualities, and we don't just unreservedly, without any qualification or reservation whatsoever, without any judgment whatsoever, recognize the beingness of all. So this is an intrinsic aspect of experiencing, of experience, and we are trying to avoid that by by seeing everything as qualifications, as needing to qualify. Well, how does this qualify? How does this qualify? Or how is this going to qualify? And how does this qualify more than that? You know, in other words, it's the mind of what's called judgment. And this blinds us to the unqualifiedness of all. It's inherently, intrinsically so. It doesn't have to qualify at all to be included in reality. There's nothing anything has to do or be as far as its qualities are concerned. You know, water, fire, air, earth, ether, whatever. It's all intrinsically qualified. Everything is all intrinsically qualified as abiding in pure spaciousness. There's no judgment needed at all for this. Now, we think that we're being good by being kind to our family members and neighbors, and some people have a more reach out to, you know, a wider circle of their tribe, you know, the tribalism. I feel all members of my tribe are, I feel they're included, and I'm not going to ask them to qualify. They're inherently qualified. But we're not talking about that here. We're talking about anything and everything that could ever possibly arise as appearance, any, you know, is intrinsically without any need for qualification whatsoever. We don't have to ever. This is it's a complete non-issue. Any universe that could ever arise is the same. Is the same. Is the same. So there is this vision of perfect sameness in that regard. This is what we're overlooking. Nothing has to prove anything. There's no necessity to prove anything, to qualify. When I mean qualify, I mean, you know, if you like qualifying to get into a university, you have a resume. Nothing needs any resume to be included in pure spaciousness. Nothing has any resume, any need for any resume whatsoever. Which means it doesn't have need for time, right? Wouldn't we need time to accumulate a resume? So the vision of oneness, vision of timelessness, vision of sameness, it's all the same. This is this non-judgmental recognition. And we're just saying, wow, right now, just okay. Getting to this, recognize this is great. I mean, you know, I'm a little shocked by this, all this. I didn't expect any of this. I just said I'll sit down and start talking, see what comes up. So it's quite shocking to get to this level, this clarity, this amount. This clarity is very strong and significant. So we say, okay, looking at, you know, the whole issue of non-judgment and the threefold aspect of God and how applying judgment to the ground of being completely skews the whole our whole experiencing and makes it one of fear instead of love or bliss. So, just like stumbling upon a cave full of treasure, we're kind of like, our mouths are open, like, oh wow. Huh. Wow. We're just sort of looking around this cave. It's just full of treasure. The most beautiful treasure. We say, holy cow, this is great. And so what do you do in that circumstance? You just sort of, you know, stand there, lean against the cave maybe a little bit, or sit down. And you say, okay. I'm not going to fixate on the treasure, right? You know, I'm not going to try and fixate on it. I'm going to accept it as best I can as normal. Okay, this is normal for me. It's normal to be seeing this. So we're transitioning to normalcy. So we say this, it's normal to see this. So what we're seeing now, what we're clear about now, oh yeah, that's just normal for me to see that, to recognize this is just entirely normal. So we act as if it is normal. Obviously, we're in the ballpark, you know, we're really in the ballpark now of look, being able to look at it like this. And so we just say, oh, this is normal. You know, I'm being in the ballpark here is entirely normal. Now, we think that we need, you know, the other way would be to think this is like super abnormal, and we start acting like we're you know, in an abnormal way. But that's not the answer. We don't go screaming and yelling, oh my gosh, look how advanced I'm seeing this, oh my gosh. We try to full stop in the wow. We recognize there's a wow, but we just normalize it. We say, okay, for me this is normal. Just nice and calm here. I know I'll see this 1,000 times again, and now in fact I'll always know this. This is part of my permanent understanding, recognition, so I'll just get used to it here. It'll be more obvious to me than breathing. Or walking, right? It'll be the most obvious. So just get used to it. So we don't want to go wandering around saying, telling everybody, you know what, I just experienced the most abnormal clarity imaginable. I mean, you can't believe how out of the ordinary it was, how extraordinary it was. Oh my gosh, it's just so... No, see, our practice, we expect the extraordinary breakthroughs. That's normal for us. So we just say, oh yeah, I had an extraordinary breakthrough, but that's entirely normal. I'm used to that. And I'm used to just sitting here and getting used to it. And pretty soon it won't seem extraordinary anymore. It'll seem quite normal. So full stop in the wow, my mind is trying to wander a little bit. And we check ourselves out, we just realize, yeah, I feel fine, everything's okay. You know, I've been looking in this treasure cave and I look about and yeah, everything's fine. It's okay to look in the treasure cave. And it's the realization that nothing has any need, the slightest need to qualify for, to present a resume in order to be perfectly included in pure spaciousness, without any possibility it could ever be not perfectly included. It's this recognition that brings about what we call enlightenment, vision of oneness. It's like the great relief. It restores our mind to proper equilibrium, as it were. We recognize, oh, there isn't any flaw in reality. Everything's fine. I don't have to fix anything. Nothing's out of whack. And this is what we call enlightenment. And it's that all is now seen, experienced, you know, properly the way it really is. Instead of thinking that everything is building up a resume, that everything has some flaw in it. The way we look at the world right now is what we see is actually we see that everything has some sort of flaw in it. It's not quite right. We look at it and we say, well, you're almost right, or you're not quite. Something isn't quite right. You're not quite in right relationship somehow. So this is our experiencing, the way we're experiencing right now, is that we're seeing an experiencing of flawedness, that nothing is perfect. It's somehow flawed in some way. We're not sure exactly what it is, but we have all sorts of ideas and concepts about it. Nothing is quite perfect, you see. You get these very rich people, and they build mansions and museums and collect vast amounts of arts and have these huge estates. They have them constantly worked on, and you know, just all this extraordinary effort, etc. But it's never quite perfect, you see. They're never quite satisfied. They're still very grumpy and upset. It's like, you know, I feel my life is slipping away. I've tried so hard, and it's still, you know, I don't understand why this is, you know. They become very sometimes distraught and suicidal. They can become. I tried so hard and I still failed. So we go from feeling as though everything has some intrinsic flaw that we can't quite determine, you know, what it is exactly. We just feel it. And it bothers us, so it pushes us to keep modifying. We go from that to this recognition that everything has this intrinsic perfection in it. It is perfectly included. There's no modification of anything that can ever change the all-inclusivity of the ground of being, pure spaciousness. There's nothing that can ever happen to ever change that all-perfect inclusiveness at all. And so we don't have to modify anything for the purpose of trying to remove its flaws. We then can modify stuff merely out of delight of creativity. So then we're restored to the true purpose of creativity is just delight, joy, not modification of anything to try and to improve it or somehow remove the flaw from it, get rid of the flaw in some way. That's all gone. And now it's just simply, everything is just a play of enjoyment and delight. No more fear. Now, people, we might say, well, we wouldn't be so creative then, because we wouldn't be being compulsively driven to modify. But the fact is that the great fear that we have about flaws and frustrations we have, that cramps our creativity to an incredible extent, actually. When we realize that there's nothing to fear at all, no flaws to remove, actually our creativity then blossoms to extraordinary extent. So just the capacity here we have to speak of this, to look at it together. All of this is actually very helpful. It helps remove the continuity fear we have, builds in familiarity, and makes us feel more at home with all of this. It doesn't seem so advanced to us, anymore. The more we look at it, the more we say, oh, this is just, basic, normal stuff. Yeah, I can understand this. That's easy. Or I can see it. I mean, I recognize it mentally. I see it mentally. My reason shows it to me. I'm able to recognize it in my mind. Also, it's like a treasure cave, so there is the wow factor here also. It's very much present, so we have to account for it. And so we try not to forge ahead at this point. Once the wow gets this strong, it's best to keep your mind from trying to forge ahead. My mind was trying to imagine, what can I say next? And something, say, no, just keep it right here. We don't want to lose sight of what we've really have been dealing with here, because it's so important. The vision of sameness has been mentioned by great teachers. This is what we need to see, the vision of sameness. So we're right here. You have to drop the judgmental aspect of mind activity, of mind, the judgmental aspect, to see the vision of sameness. Or at least we have to include the non-judgmentalness. Judgmentalness in terms of all-inclusiveness, inherent all-inclusiveness, is simply a whim that we're having. This is not the same meaning of judgmentalness in terms of appreciation of appearance and all the different delight that it gives you. There's a different connotation to that, different meaning to that. And the idea that appearance and experiencing will lose its delight to us when we see that there's this inherent sameness to it is nonsense. In fact, it will all become way